you know, and we're here, learning more about being lawyers. Boring lawyers. Okay. So this session is less meaty. There aren't going to be any statutes put up on the board.
But no less meaty.
Right, but no less meaty. We're going to talk about, you know, law is theater and theater is law, and it's something, you know, going through the early years of my career and the later years of my career at home with a playwright, I get a lot of, you know, you say too much. Your hands are getting in your way. And so I've learned to live with that. And, and occasionally I get some good advice. And this panel is going to talk about the theater of the trial practice. And it's a great panel. We have Geri Satin, who began her legal career as an associate at Stearns Weaver and is now in the trial consulting business at Focus Litigation
Consulting.
Close. And she is helping put together mock juries and advising lawyers on how to look like lawyers and not offend judges and juries and everything that goes into that part of the practice. And I can tell you, as she began as an associate, she had no fear in telling me how I was doing, which is, you know, if I was putting on a witness and asking the wrong question, I got a hit in the ribs, and it was explained to me what I should be doing properly, which I'm very coachable, and I always appreciated that. Gail Garrisan is one of the great directors in South Florida theater, and a dear, dear friend, and over the years has had a big hand in a lot of years of summer shorts. It's great having her here, and she's going to add to this discussion. And Professor Caisley is here, and Steve has seen him in action, and he works as a trial consultant, and I hear you're fabulous and magnificent.
No, he's lying. I've never done this before.
And I'm looking forward to hearing what you have to say. And you've got a great panel to work with, and I'll let you go.
Well, thank you. Thanks so much.
Yeah.
And I just want to thank the planners of the City Rights Festival.
I said too much, too, didn't I?
Well, that's all right. Yeah. We'll let it go this time. We won't slap you too much. The organizers, I think, did a pretty good job of putting us together in the same panel here. We only have about an hour and a half, and normally when I do storytelling workshops with trial lawyers, I do like a six-hour CLE. It's kind of a boot camp, a litigation boot camp, I generally call it. And so I'm not going to try to cram everything I do into 6 hours into 25 minutes. I'll try to provide some substantive information for you, but I'm not going to try to race through material so I sound more like an auctioneer than presenting on advocacy skills. But we have some folks today who are going to talk about image, some folks today who are going to talk about body and voice awareness, and my focus is quite different from that. A little bit about who I am. I teach at the University of Idaho, and I run the dramatic writing program. And my area of expertise is primarily in story theory. So those dusty, crusty Greeks, the Aristotelians, who first gave us the two arts of rhetoric and drama. And of course, rhetoric would be something that you're quite familiar with. Dramatic techniques, perhaps not so familiar with, and I'd like to maybe shed a little light on that. How I got into this, about 7 years ago, I had a play that I had directed that was invited to go to the Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C. And the university is always quick to create a little dog and pony show whenever they have professors who have something happening on the national level. They invited me to a fundraiser in Seattle. And unbeknownst to me, when I got up, at that point I'd been working on the play for about a year and a half. And I was actually sick of talking about this production. So instead of talking about the play, I decided instead to talk about the role of the artist within society and the more broader nature of storytelling and its social effect, what it can do to change the world. Afterwards, at the little wine and cheese cubey thing, I was accosted, and I was accosted by about 20 lawyers who had all come back from Jerry Spence's ranch in Wyoming and had formed a group called the TLC group. They were all part of the Washington State Trial Lawyers Association, and they got together on a regular basis to drink wine, and then also talk about their cases that they were working on, to kind of troubleshoot them, to workshop them. And they said, you know, one of the partners of this firm owns a cabin on Mount Rainier. We'd like to invite you to come out and spend the weekend with 25 lawyers. Well, you can imagine the prospect of this was harrowing, to say the least. But when I find out that the partners had a rather extensive wine collection, and myself being a bit of a, well, what's the technical term? Lush, I think is the technical term. I decided that I would try this. And I said, look, I don't know anything about the law. I've never taken a law class. I don't know anything. I love Law and Order. I love Sam Waterston. But other than that, I don't feel like I have any credentials or credibility in these circles. I said, but I tell you what I do. What I do is I help my playwriting students and my directing students organize a collection of loose facts into a cohesive narrative that hopefully is interesting, clear, and emotionally compelling. And I teach these students, writers and directors, to be able to make an audience focus on certain parts of a story and not focus on other parts of a story, and move things back and forth. And I also hope that at the end of that experience for an audience, they will arrive at an emotional and intellectual conclusion about the facts that I've been presenting in the story that's the same conclusion that I arrive at as a storyteller. And they said, oh yeah, that's exactly what we do. And so I began, that's when I began to be an autodidact about the nature of litigation narrative, and particularly about what happens in personal injury. Because I saw the world of personal injury as really being the same world as dramatic storytelling, where one individual is wronged and slighted or hurt by another and must seek some kind of redress. And so I started taking Aristotle, and I'll go ahead and sort of confess that everything that I will say to you today has been plagiarized by Aristotle, from Aristotle. Someone far smarter than I am once said that everything that's been written on the nature of dramatic storytelling and the art of drama is really just 2,500 years of footnotes to Aristotle. And it's true, you cannot pick up a playwriting book, a book about screenwriting, without seeing the long homage to the first and probably greatest treatise on dramatic storytelling, which is Aristotle's The Poetics. It's the companion piece to Rhetoric, okay? And it's very short, and it's incomplete. It probably isn't even something that he intended to publish in any way, shape, or form. It's a fragment, and it's more likely his lecture notes when he was walking around the Lyceum in Athens 2,500 years ago, lecturing in that classical peripatetic way, walking with his students and telling them about the nature of storytelling. And he was also looking back 100 years on the golden age of Greece, where drama was born in the Western civilization, and all of the formal conventions of storytelling were created. So everything I say to you, I've stolen from Aristotle, and I'm just regurgitating it. And the other dirty little secret I'd like to share with you is that everything I know about storytelling is very, very simple. And you already know how to do it. But I bet you've forgotten how to do it. But I bet if any of you have children in this room, they know it better than you do. They know they have more imagination than you do. They understand logic of linear storytelling better than you do. If I'm telling my story, I tell stories to my kids before they go to bed. And I make them up, because I'm a playwright, so I make up the stories. But if on Tuesday night, I end the story, and then on Wednesday, I try to pick it up again, and they say, whoa, 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 hold on a second. Well, when last we met that cat, they correct me on my structure. They're very quick to point out deficiencies in my storytelling. And so kids are better storytellers than we are. And it's not rocket science. It's really, really simple. In fact, Aristotle basically had 6 rules of storytelling, okay? And all of these rules of storytelling were about making something dramatic. Now, I want to dispel what I mean by dramatic, because it's got a negative connotation, okay? When I say dramatic to a bunch of lawyers, okay, you think emotional. I am not advocating for you in front of a jury to get emotional. That's not going to work, because you know what? It looks fake. It looks fake, and in this era of tort reform, you get picked out a mile away, okay? But you can be a convincing and effective storyteller if you understand some of the basic rules of dramatic storytelling, okay? So what I mean by dramatic is that the stories that you try to tell have what I call inevitable momentum. From the moment that you start the story, it starts to build speed toward its inevitable conclusion. Playwrights are great at doing this. And Shakespeare, one of the best, was brilliant at creating a play that at a certain point has to go inevitably towards a certain conclusion. Okay? So imagine it like a roller coaster, that when it reaches a certain part of that structure, the energy of the thing carries it through the rest of the ride. And a good story does that. You've experienced it yourself, either in the theater or watching a movie or even reading a great page turner, that natural effect. So you should be able to adapt these things for the kinds of stories you may be trying to tell at trial, or even when you're trying to write something that's the least bit persuasive. There are ways to create that inevitable momentum, okay? Dramatic stories also have a specific shape to them, okay? A specific shape. Some of them are linear, and word for word, dollar for dollar, the best way to tell a story is linearly. But you may be handling a case that it doesn't make sense to begin in a linear fashion. You may want to kind of chop up the narrative in a slightly different way, okay? So Aristotle had these 6 elements. I won't be able to cover all of them in today's presentation, but I'll cover what I think are the most important to you as lawyers. Of these 6 elements, Aristotle said the most important one is plot. Now, what's your understanding of plot? Anyone, just like a freshman in English class, what is plot? What is plot? Bueller? Bueller?
Story.
Story?
Beginning, middle, and end.
Okay.
What happens, the action.
Okay, good. All of these things are correct. Okay, well, let me give you a little story, okay? Something you'll all know. Jack and Jill went up the hill to fetch a pail of water. Jack fell down, broke his crown, and Jill came tumbling after. That's a story, right? Is it a plot? Is that a plot?
No.
Yes.
No? Yes? Oh, lawyers arguing? I can't believe it. Unheard of. Well then, could I also tell it in this way? Act 1, scene 1, a hospital room. Jack in bed with a broken crown. Tubes in every orifice. In comes Jill. Jack, about what happened last night on the Hill. I want to explain. Shut up, Jill. You're dead to me. It's over. Okay? I don't want to talk about it. Blackout. Flashback to the Hill, the pail of water, etc. It's the same story, but I have just inverted the way I tell it. So it's important as you are constructing your story to figure out what's the best way to tell that story in trial. What's the best way to convey your client's story? Is it in linear fashion or not? And also, where do you begin the story? Where you begin the story has to do with everything, okay? Let's suppose you're working on the kinds of cases I've worked on in the past, just to give you a snapshot. It's been a variety. I've done a lot of medical malpractice. I've done a lot of wrongful death, product liability, slip and fall, maritime accidents, a lot of single engine plane crashes for some particular reason, sexual abuse cases, and I hate to say it in a room full of lawyers, but I've also done an awful lot of legal malpractice as well. Lawyers suing other lawyers for botching some aspect of their representation of another client, okay? That's just but let's suppose you're working on some kind of product liability case where you've got a plane crash incident. This is coming from a specific example where there was a manufacturing flaw in a carburetor of a single engine plane. Now, we may not want to begin the story on the day that the plane went down and all five family members were killed in that plane crash. We may want to start the story 3.5 years ago when that carburetor was manufactured at that factory that we're now suing. So making aesthetic choices really dictates the kind of story you're going to tell. So think of it this way. The plot is not simply the events in a story. Okay? It is not simply the arrangement of those events, but it is also the orchestration of those events. And by orchestration, I mean the scaling of those events, so that each piece builds one upon the other. Another way to look at it, it's called dialectics for the Marxists in the room. Dialectics says that the collision of two ideas creates a third idea. This is the only way that you're able to sit at home and enjoy a movie. Perfect example. There's a shot of man looking out window. Okay? That's the shot. Okay? Man looking out window. Man looking out window, smiling. Okay? Now what the human brain does, every few seconds, little electrons and synapses snapping, it basically says, every few seconds, what happens next? And as a storyteller, if you don't supply what happens next, the human brain will surmise. It will anticipate. The human brain will get ahead of you as the storyteller. So the storyteller has always got to be a few steps ahead, not too far ahead, but a few steps ahead of the audience, of the jury. Okay? So, shot of man looking out window, smiling. Cut to, the next shot is children playing in the street, okay? Now the brain then collides those two ideas. Man looking out window, smiling, children playing in the street. And so we then put those ideas together and say, oh, he's maybe the father of one of the children. He's smiling because he sees his son or daughter having a fun time in the street. Okay, take that same shot, man looking out window, smiling. Actor hasn't done anything differently. It's the same piece of film. Man looking out window, smiling. Cut to old woman being beaten in the street. An entirely different story has unfolded, even though the first shot was exactly the same as in the first example. So one of the things as a storyteller you have to be aware of is not simply the pieces that you select to put in your story, but how you connect them. The connective, kinetic tissue between the individual frames, if you will, or scenes of your trial story. Does that sort of make sense? And that's what plot is in the Aristotelian sense of the word. So think of it like this. It's like the idea is that plot of these individual pieces that you hang on a washing line, okay? And the theme is that thing which kind of holds it all together. Without the theme, you have buckus. You don't have a story. You don't have a story. You've got a bunch of random facts. Now, I have read some of the crap that you people have to wade through on a regular basis. Just the sheer volume of information is daunting. It's daunting. I'm fairly dumb, but I'm not that dumb, because they gave me a full professorship recently at the University of Idaho. But some of that stuff is daunting. It's probably daunting for you. So you can bet your bottom dollar it's incredibly daunting and boring and tedious to your audience, to your jury. So you better be very clear about what you choose to put on that washing line, how you choose to arrange it. And I've met with many attorneys who, well, first of all, the very first thing I say to the attorney who calls me up and says, hey, Rob, we want you to consult on this case, is I say, well, why don't you tell me about it? Well, about an hour later, and I say, no. Can you tell me that story in 3 sentences? That's what I do with my playwriting students. If they can't tell me what their play is about in 3 sentences, they don't know what the story is. They don't know what the story is. So we do these kind of little mini workshops where we take all of the fact patterns on the case and we say, let's see if we can boil it down to 3 simple sentences and then a coda. One sentence would suggest who the antagonist is in the story. Okay? Now, generally in a film or a movie or novel or a play, what I want to do as a storyteller is introduce my hero first, my protagonist. But I have to do exactly the opposite when I'm telling a trial story. Because the minute the audience hears about a certain person in a context where someone's going to assign blame, they assign it to the first person that they hear. So you want to bring up the harmful actions of the defendant before you ever talk about your lovely client. Okay? Because you tell the story of the harmful actions of the defendant. That's the first part of your story, always. So, this is the notion of creating plot, okay? So you've outlined the harmful actions of the defendant. You've outlined in this premise, I call it a thumbnail sketch of the case, 3 sentences in a coda. Who's the defendant? What did they do? What was the effect of that? And then wrap it up and name the parties, okay? So for example, I was working on this case where this physician had prescribed and overprescribed, actually, a series of medicines over the course of several months and years to a person who eventually became addicted to that particular cocktail, overdosed and died, okay? And when I first heard about the case, it was probably 45 minutes of the lawyer explaining to me all of the meds that they took, when they took them, the dosages, the very, you know, all of the technical names of these things. And I said, okay, well, let's boil it down. A doctor overprescribes medicine for a patient. The patient becomes addicted and died. That doctor killed that patient. The doctor was X, the patient was Y. Simple to understand. Now, the attorney got very excited about this. And they started answering the phone when opposing counsel would call by saying, a doctor overprescribed medicine to a patient. The patient became addicted and died. That doctor killed that patient. It would drive the other people nuts. He would type it on memos. It had the effect of making opposing counsel feel that this is the story. And it created in the attorney this sense of confidence about what they had to present in very simple terms, how they needed to assign blame in this particular story. So think about a case that you might be taking to trial soon, and see if you can actually boil it down to 3 sentences and a coda. Just as a little exercise to yourself. So, think of it like this. The plot of the story is the what happens. And the theme is always the why. One of the things that I do for attorneys, sometimes I'll help them structure and write opening statements or closing arguments. Sometimes I'll do victim impact statements or a day in the life video, for settlement videos. I'll do the scripts for the settlement videos. Scripts, by the way, what I mean by script is that, not that I'm inventing information. What I'm doing is the script for a settlement video you write after you've got all the interviews with the family members in the can. And then you go through the transcript of what everyone said and you construct the most compelling story that articulates the damages. And it's particularly useful in creating a very compelling story of damages. Emotionally, to jar the opposing counsel, and to also bring about the largest amount of damages that you possibly can. With plot is always the what of the story, and theme is always the why. And the number one thing that firms that retain me want to know is, what's the case theme? I think this has become like a sexy thing, maybe, in the law. You've got to have a case theme. You've got to have a case theme. And so I provide them with, identify within the materials what I think is the most compelling theme. And the truth of the matter is, I can think, probably, of two themes that apply to every personal injury lawsuit. Now, what I have done in order to not put myself out of business as a consultant is I've come up with a very long list of themes, case themes, that you can adopt and apply to your particular story. And this is the same in playwriting and storytelling universally as in law. For thousands of years, people have been trying to quantify universal stories. First in the Renaissance by Carlo Gozzi. Okay? There was a very famous book called The 36 Dramatic Situations. You may have heard of this book. And most recently, there's a terrific book called The 7 Basic Plots. It's a wonderful book, and it basically boils all of Western and much of Eastern literature down to 7 basic plots. So if I said to you, okay, oh my gosh, there's a small coastal village that's being terrorized by a water beast of extraordinary size, and a lone hero comes to the town to defeat this beast, thereby returning the town to a sense of safety, equilibrium. Some of you may think, well, that's Jaws. And others may think, well, that's Beowulf. Because it's exactly the same story. And more I start studying trial stories, I see that many of them are exactly the same story. Why reinvent the wheel? Use the structures. These stories are the same because there are some things that always happen to human beings, and one of them is betrayal. And that's what all personal injury lawsuits are based on. And if you can get a jury to understand betrayal, you will get them angry. And my job when crafting a trial story is to generate a story which gets them angry. Because if they're angry, they're going to award money. That's the nature of what I do. So think about the universal and archetypal kinds of stories there are. Another one that I always find coincides and goes hand in hand, so that's the what, so we're talking about the why. What goes hand in hand with betrayal, and think about that. You may not have been fired for your job, you know, wrongfully terminated from your job. You may not have been hurt on the job and the insurance company fails to cover. You may not have died in a single engine plane crash. That may not have been the kind of betrayal, but everybody's been cheated on. Everyone's been backstabbed. We understand as human beings and have a very gut reptilian reaction to betrayal. And I'm sure many of you have already read the book about the reptile brain, right? About the primeval reactions that we have to things. Okay? We have a primeval reaction to our families, to protect our families, and by extension, our communities. So if you've got a trial story which involves someone disrupting a community or a family, it appeals to the reptilian side of people's brains in the jury. Okay? So this notion of theme. Arthur Miller, great American playwright. We need to wrap up. Just give you this one last anecdote. Arthur Miller, this great American playwright, he said, he wrote a companion piece to Death of a Salesman in the New York Times. It was an essay called Tragedy in the Common Man. And he said in that landmark essay that we understand we're in the presence of tragedy when we're confronted with a character who will do anything, lay down their life if need be, to achieve one thing and one thing only, to regain their sense of personal dignity. And so think about how that applies also to the notion of personal injury lawsuits. The person can't get back their job, they can't get back their legs, they can't get back their house, but what they want to get back and what the jury can award is their sense of personal dignity. Anyway, I'm out of time. I'm getting hooked off the stage. So.
Oh, okay. While you're switching off, I would say, just as somebody who does a little personal injury and a lot of commercial stuff,
yeah,
everything you say is equally true to commercial litigation.
Oh, okay.
There's a big Ponzi scheme or an architect that overbills his client and does a lot of work that he really doesn't need to and creates a lot of problems. It's all the same story. Same betrayal, and at the end of the day, you want to get their dignity back. It's a lot of times just good old money.
Good old money. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Geri Satin. I am the rebel ex-turn sweeper associate who decided to become a trial consultant. And a lot of what I do is focus on witness preparation tools. And a lot of times what happens is when you're working with a witness, the lawyer then says, well, what about me? And so a lot of the tools that you can utilize when prepping witnesses for trials are also applicable to attorneys. So what I'm going to talk about today are some of the visual presentation tools that you as attorneys and budding attorneys, as well as the witnesses that you're going to prep for trial, can use in court, how you can speak volumes without saying a word. And Kelly, if you could just let me know when like 25 minutes are up, so I don't take any of this time, that would be great. One of the most basic things that I wanted to talk about, specifically for the budding attorneys, some of the seasoned attorneys in the room already know this, is what is appropriate to wear in court. There are some rebel attorneys out there, the Johnny Cochrans of the world, who wear periwinkle suits into court, and it serves them well. But for the most part, think of what you can wear to court as what you would feel comfortable wearing to some sort of a religious ceremony. And what that means is you need to be extremely conservative. Some of the do's and don'ts include, do's include for men wearing a long sleeve shirt, staying away from anything that, as I like to say, is relatively blingy. So for men, and attire in the courtroom to a much more intricate level. And right now I'm pursuing a PhD in legal psychology, so I'm spending quite a bit of time in the legal psychology lab. So what I'm going to do today is try to back a lot of what I'm saying with empirical data, so you know that this is not just fluff. This stuff actually matters. There's research on it. So one of the things that I want to talk to you first about when it comes to your appearance and attire in the courtroom is color, and how color can be utilized not only in what you when it comes to color, we have reactions to colors, we have emotional reactions, and we have physiological reactions. So when we think of colors, when we see a color, for example, we actually have a visceral warm colors, and you think of cool colors. So when we think of warm colors, we think of reds, oranges, yellows. We think of the sun. We think of fire. We think of warmth. When we think of cool-based colors, like, for example, blues and greens, we think of the ocean. We think of the sky. We think of things that are tranquil. A lot of times with demonstrative aids in court, you're trying to relay information, but you're also trying to get an emotional reaction from the trier of fact, whether that's a judge, jury, an arbitration panel, or a mediator. So oftentimes the colors that you use in your demonstrative aids, if you want to, for example, evoke emotions that are calming, you're gonna wanna use more blue-based colors, more cool colors, than warm-based colors. Another interesting aspect of color that most people don't know about is it actually affects depth perception. So, for example, when you're looking at colors that are warm-based, red-based colors, orange, yellows, the actual image that you're looking at looks closer to you than it actually is. And the opposite is true when it comes to cool-based colors. So when you're looking at an image that's cool-based, it looks further away than it actually is. So how, from a practical standpoint, could you utilize that in court? Well, if you have a demonstrative aid, for example, that's from an eyewitness perspective, and you as the lawyer are trying to show that they were really way too far away to have been able to credibly see what's going on at the scene of the crime or whatever it is, you can actually use a lens and have the picture appear more cool-based. It'll actually look further away from the juror's perspective. And these are ways to actually make a reaction, have an emotional reaction, emotional perception from jurors without you having to say it. Which, as Robert was explaining before, is the most powerful way to do things. If you're telling them things, if they're coming up with this on their own, then you've achieved your goal. So that's one thing to keep in mind with color. Another aspect of color that's often overlooked but equally important in the courtroom are the colors you wear. And I get this question a lot from people, oh, I have this, this color on, does it compliment me? And you know, I laugh and I say, well, it depends what you're trying to achieve. So we all have different complexions, different undertones to our skin. Some of us have yellow-based undertones, some of us have blue-based undertones. We also have different overtones to our skin, our hair, eyes, eyebrows, etc. So there are certain colors, and we're all unique, it's a different color palette for each of us, that complement us individually, and there are colors that don't. So the colors that complement us, for example, they will reduce the sign of blemishes, they'll reduce bags under your eyes, wrinkles, they actually can lift your skin, they harmonize your body, they make you appear more dominant, more powerful, you have more of a presence in the room. So if that's what you're seeking to achieve in court, then those are the colors you should be wearing, especially as close as possible to your face. Now, what if on the other hand you're about to cross-examine a witness who's some evil corporate rep, and what you think he's done is completely sickening. But you don't want to say that. You're cross-examining him. I mean, there's no way a judge is going to let you say that. So what do? You look sickened. You look sickened. You look sickened by everything he's saying without so much as saying that. So color is a very, very powerful tool, often underutilized by attorneys, but can have drastic impact on your visual presentation. Another aspect of attire and appearance that's often underutilized but equally as important when it comes to visual presentation is fit. Now, most lawyers know, okay, I shouldn't wear a suit that's too baggy or too tight, but sometimes you can make little tweaks in your attire that can affect the way you appear to a jury or the way your witness appears to a jury. So let's say you have a witness and he's this big burly guy and he's aggressive and he's overbearing and he's not, as they say, likable. He's not a likable witness to a jury. If you place him in clothes that are just a touch too big for him, you are shrinking him. You are literally shrinking him. And you, in a way, are neutralizing him as a witness. Obviously, the opposite is true as well. You can make someone who's a little bit of a meek witness or a meek attorney who's not used to getting up in front of a jury and giving an opening statement. You can make them look more powerful by shortening their sleeves a tiny bit, changing the cuffs on their pants. These are all tools that you can utilize. Again, you're not saying a word, you're making an impact on the judge or jury. Okay, last but not least, body language. There's sort of two aspects of body language, and Gail's gonna get into this a little bit more. But when it comes to body language, it's important to understand the body language you're giving off, but also to be able to read the body language of the trier of fact, which a lot of lawyers don't do. As second chair many times, not with Alan, of course, but with other attorneys, I've seen the judge or jurors getting agitated, getting annoyed, getting bored, and the lawyer will talk on and on and on, and they've lost their audience. They're done. So it's not only important to understand your body language, but to be able to read the body language of others. So some of the some sort of basic body language tips. What can we say are like negative body language that we see in people?
Arms crossed.
Arms crossed. Anyone else?
Shifting.
Eye rolling.
Eye rolling.
Sleeping
is a good one. How about this? This is one. Or what about the tight-lipped smile? It's like I have something to say, but I'm not going to tell you, and it's probably negative. So what do you do? What do you do? First of all, you have to be perceptive. You have to be aware of these things. And once you're aware of them, you have to figure out a way to fix them. So when it comes to a jury, for example, what's a great way to fix crossed arms? Hand them an exhibit. There's academic research that shows that when people sit in a negative body language position for a long time, they start feeling the emotional effects of it. So even if someone crosses their hands because they're cold, if they keep their hands crossed for a long enough time, they're gonna have a negative reaction to what you're saying, and they're not gonna be listening to anything you're saying after a little bit. So hand them an exhibit. A lot of juries are allowed to take notes now. Say something that you think will incentivize them to take notes. See if there's a way to get the judge to take a break. If jurors seem like they're antsy, judges are always willing to take breaks. So the best way to fix negative body language is to spur a change in the body language. So those are some of the basic body language tools. I wanted to sort of finish up by presenting you guys with some recent stereotype, courtroom stereotype behavior that you as attorneys and budding attorneys should know when you are in the courtroom. So when it comes to dealing with a judge and jury, a lot of times in jury selection, a lot of the questions surround stereotypes and bias, because what lawyers are trying to do is pick an impartial jury. I was watching the George Zimmerman trial live streaming this morning, and every single question was to vet out juror bias. That's what you do in voir dire. And jurors, the danger when it comes to bias is that we as humans have biases that we don't even know we have. We have racial, we have gender, we have age, we have facial appearance biases that a lot of times we can sit on a jury and say, oh, I'll be impartial, but you can't control your subliminal reaction to things. So you may think you're being impartial, but you may not actually be impartial. So as attorneys, it's important to understand some of these stereotypes as they apply in the courtroom context to be able to avoid falling victim to them, if you will. The first stereotype that I want to address is weight and gender stereotypes. So there was a recent study done by the Yale Rudd Center for Food Policy and Obesity, and what they did is they presented almost 500 participants with a scenario, a mock trial scenario. It was alleged check fraud. And what they did is they showed them pictures of one of the four defendants. One was a lean male, a lean female, an obese male, and an obese female. And what they found overwhelmingly was that men more severely punished women defendants who were obese. Women had the ability to impartially judge male and female defendants irrespective of weight. But when it came to male jurors, they more harshly punished female defendants who are obese. It's something that's awful, but it's something that you need to know and something that you need to be aware of when you are representing clients in the courtroom. Because what does this mean? Let's say, for example, you have a client that you're representing who's a female who's overweight. And let's say you are picking a jury. There are a couple tools to combat this. You can try to vet out bias in jury selection. You can issue an instruction that people should not be biased to weight and gender. But a lot of times those tools don't work. Another way to combat this is to try to make sure you have more women on your jury. So these are things you have to keep in mind. Another aspect of this is, let's say you're representing a company and you're choosing your 30B6 witness, who for the budding attorneys is the person with the most information on the case. A lot of times in these corporate cases, you have the ability to pick who the 30B6 witness is going to be. So if you know it's a jury trial, a lot of times, if you're having a videotaped deposition taken or something like that, this is something you need to be aware of and perhaps pick your corporate rep accordingly. Another stereotype that there's been a lot of research in the courtroom over is what they call the baby face stereotype. So as a practical matter, people with babyish faces, so what's that, like large eyes, thin eyebrows, large head, curved features, are considered more likable to jurors. Jurors respond well to them. They think that they're more innocent. They don't want them to be guilty. Whereas people with more angular, kind of harsh features that have a more mature look are more harshly punished by jurors. And there was a string of research done in the 1970s on this. There's sort of a corollary effect as well, which is if a person who has a baby face admits liability, they admit that they committed a crime, they are more harshly punished because jurors feel like there's been some kind of like a breach in trust, like they wanted to find them innocent, but now they've breached the trust, so they're more harshly punished. So how do you combat this from a practical standpoint? If you have somebody who has a more mature look, you reverse the effects of this. You create more baby face features for them. And you can do that by combating it with a haircut, changing their haircut to be more curved rather than angular. You can do it with eyeglasses. You can do it with the shapes that they're wearing. You can do it with the colors of their outfit. You can make them appear more baby-faced and more likable. And the last stereotype that I want to address is the stereotype called the glasses stereotype. And it's also been coined the nerd stereotype. And now everyone's starting to feel self-conscious in the room. and so what the glasses stereotype is there was some research done back in the 1970s on whether jurors responded well, what their reaction was to defendants who wore glasses and defendants who did not wear glasses. And what they found was that defendants who wore glasses were found to be less attractive and more intelligent. And the research showed that when defendants are found to be less attractive, they're given harsher penalties, more liability, more damages, higher sentencing. When they're found to be more intelligent, the opposite is true. So what the research concluded was it's sort of like a mixed bag, who knows, but more recently, with the onslaught of kind of like thick-rimmed, cool glasses coming out, they revisited the research and they saw, what they did was they took a look at different types of glasses. So defendants who were not wearing glasses, who were wearing rimless glasses, and who were wearing thick-rimmed glasses, sort of like the ones that I'm wearing right now. And what they found was that potential jurors viewed people with thick-rimmed glasses as less attractive and more intelligent. So again, it was a mixed bag, but what was really interesting about the research was they viewed people with rimless glasses as more intelligent and equally as attractive as people without glasses. So in a sense, what that tells us is that if you have a defendant who needs to wear glasses, even if they're wearing the coolest glasses in the world, super thick rimmed Dwayne Wade glasses, they shouldn't be wearing them in the courtroom. But, and we've seen that before. We've seen a total rebranding done by Jodi Arias just recently. She was wearing some pretty thick glasses. Not to say that that's the reason why things went awry for her. She probably shouldn't have taken the witness stand. But all to say, so these are some of the visual presentation tools that can really affect how your courtroom presentation goes and are important to keep in mind. And thank you so much. If you have any other questions, I'm happy to talk to you.
While Gail's coming up, when Geri told me that she sat next to me in the office next to me, and she told me that she was leaving to go do this kind of work, and then she was still with us for a couple of months, and every day I walked in, I was thinking, I'm wondering how I'm looking. If I had a new suit on, she would never say anything. I just got this tie for Father's Day. I picked it out myself, and I said, well, what do you think of my tie? It's a new tie. She told me she might tell me during the presentation, but so, anyway.
I just found out that I'm going to the slammer. Angular face and thick glasses.
Yeah.
I'm scared now. 6 months ago, I had the clear ones, and I was baby face.
All right. Hi, I am Gail Garrison. I am a director. I'm going to direct you now, little. My big, fat, cool glasses. I also have visual aids. I want to go back to our wine theme. I'm a director, and I teach acting and directing at New World School of the Arts, which is just down the street in the college over there. And I want to dovetail a little bit on what Geri said around the stereotypes and from my own experience on the jury, because I've actually been on the jury. And so I did want to talk a little bit about that, because there is a bias, not just for the people that you're defending, but about you too when you're on a jury. You probably know that. But I love everything that we're talking about, because all of us are just human beings. And you know this. You know that you make a decision about people the moment that you see them. You know that as people. You all agree? Mm-hmm. You do. And you don't want to forget that somebody has an opinion about you. And I know, from when I was younger, and had even higher cheekbones, that it was assumed by a lot of people that I was a snob just by having, my face, the face that I had. Sans wrinkles. And I remember when I was in college, and it was a big lesson, and I want us all to learn this. It was a big lesson, because I really am, and I'm not really a snob. But there was a girl that said, Jill, I really hated you for so long. She had never spoken to me. She made an assumption based on what I looked like. And we do it all the time. And when I was on a jury, and it was when I was still lived in New York, I really didn't like the lawyer. I didn't like what he was wearing, and I didn't like the way he sounded. Because he was a wise guy, his speech wasn't good, and okay, that's part of my training, speech is important to me. But because he was such a wise guy, and because he had such a harsh demeanor, I automatically started making decisions. And he was defending lawyer, so that wasn't good. I'm watching this and I was talking to myself and going, just stop having that inner monologue. But nonetheless, it was affecting me. And that's something that we need to remember all the time. It does affect you. So what you wear, what your body language is, not just, you looking at what the jury's body language is, you need to look at you and see how you're carrying yourself. What vocal, power you have or what you don't have, the effect that you're having, are you dropping out the end of the sentence? You're talking to the jury, you might be pointing. And the jury, one hand you can say, well, they're listening to me now. No, they're not. No, they're not. They've been sitting in a chair for several hours. Their arms probably are crossed and they're getting angry and wanting a drink. Okay, I'm sorry, that was me. They're getting a little irritated, so your job, it is show business. You know it, but you need to know it and not forget it on any given day. It's what you do.
but it's also how you do it and the energy with which you do it. Do you know? So you don't want to ever forget that. That's really, really important. Because if you're one of the, you know, one of the things that we talk about in acting all the time is action, action, action. It's always an action. What are you doing on stage? You have an action. It's not what you want. It's not what you are going to get. I want to get an emotion. Emotion comes along for the ride. You know what I mean? Like that? If I'm being truthful, if I'm going for what I want, the emotion will come along for the ride. Anyone want to do an improv with me? Yes. Someone?
Sure.
Okay. If I say to you, why are you wearing that suit? Why?
Because
why?
Hey, get
why are you wearing that suit?
Get out of my face. Right now, get out of my face. You have no style, you have no class,
no, no,
you have
no,
nobody.
You didn't
talk to me like that.
Stop. You didn't answer the question.
And we're going to.
But you didn't answer the question. What just happened?
I laughed, I cried.
She didn't have to do, I didn't have to, you know, all I had to do was ask the question, yes? Bam. What happened vocally? What happened?
With me or with you?
With you.
Oh, my voice went up, got louder,
right.
Shriller.
So she didn't have to, I didn't have to do much to get her to do much. Do you know? So remember that the emotion comes along for the ride, but it's up to you to evoke the emotion. You're evoking the emotion in the jury. You're evoking the emotion. Don't talk with the judge, he's out there being really, you know. But you really, it's in your power. It's all in your power. And I really want you to believe that. And also to know that you have an instrument, right? Here's your instrument. You have to know how to use it. And I want you to think of that, your body as your instrument, on lots of different levels.
I have a question.
Yes.
I don't think you would have gotten the same reaction from every volunteer.
No. All right, who wants to be a volunteer?
I mean, I wouldn't have reacted.
You
like that.
Would not have. Get up here.
I'm talking to Grove Train, he's going to come back right now.
But do you think a jurist who has, I mean, you wouldn't be doing that to a jury.
I would never. I would never do that.
My point is that lawyers never ask questions without knowing the answer.
No, no, no. You're just talking about if you were, no, you're not going to do that to a jury, a person on the stand necessarily. That was just a point of view that, you know, you don't have to work as hard as you think, but you have to be clear on what you want, whatever you want, and whenever you want. This works in life too, people. Just be clear. Okay. You just have, B. All right? Hi.
Hi.
How are you?
Good.
No, you look good. Do you feel good? You look a little tentative.
No, I feel fine.
You good?
I don't know your name.
Do you live down here?
Yes.
So where do you live?
Key Biscayne.
I love Key Biscayne. Do you like it?
I'm moving away.
That's so sad. Do you want to move away?
Yeah.
Okay, so what's your response to what I'm giving you?
You're trying to be aggressively friendly and get me to be friendly to you. But my natural reaction to people like that is probably to back away. And that was my point.
That's good.
I don't.
That's your natural reaction. I didn't have to do anything
to
you.
Yeah, no, but I'm saying is she...
No,
people have different reactions.
Absolutely.
I don't like people to be overly friendly, usually.
I'm not going
usually
to ever do that again. The point is, your response is your response.
Yeah.
And you're of course, you're a lawyer, and I'm also like, your response is your response, but it's a truthful response. So if you go for something and you go for it truthfully, remember, you know, then the person
but my
going
point is
have
that you
response.
Have to be really careful.
You do have to be careful.
You can't just decide that this is the theme you're going to want and
good,
then
you don't
know the reaction. You know, no. People are really different. And I think juries are really different. They're individuals.
But you will get a response is the point. So if
you'll get 12.
Yes. You will. I'm not going to argue with a lawyer. I have them in my family. I never won.
number one. You will get 12, but you will get a response. So the point was, you want to be careful of the response that you get, and you want to be choosing the right actions to get it. And there are lots of different actions. And sometimes when you are on little handouts for you all, especially this side of the table. I understand that you're the young associates, or young, what are they?
Turks.
Our summer associates.
Okay. Pass them all. There's tongue twisters and there are action words. So when you're standing in front of people, if you use the same action over and over again, what happens?
They get bored.
So if you're not using some kind of choosing different actions, the ones that you need, the ones to get the response that you want, also some vocal color to get what you want, you may fall in, the action becomes almost too drone. You know what I mean? So all you start to hear is white noise. And that's what the jury starts to hear, is the white noise, rather than the color. And these are things that we hand out in acting. I'd like to say that I prepared this just for you, but that would not be true. I actually prepared for my acting class, but it's a good case in point. The first couple pages are tongue twisters, and the second, if you look, turn that over, you're going to see a lot of action words. And that was my point, Edith, that there are lots of actions to get where you're going. There's not just one. So when you're assessing your jury, and when you're taking the cues that Geri was talking about, the body language, and when, because you've already, chosen these people, you've chosen these people for a reason, then you have to remember that you've chosen them for a reason, from the expectation for what you want from them, and make sure that you get it. Now, you never know. They are all different people. And that's why understanding human nature becomes really important. Become human nature. How many stories are there, Bob? The seven stories?
Seven basic wands.
There are seven basic wands. Well, there are, we are all different, but there are things about us that are all similar. So you want to start to think about that and really put it into practice. The other thing is just using your voice. Anybody shy about using your voice? Anybody get nervous speaking in front of people yet? Anybody? No, you're all really great. Okay, who wants to get up and speak in front of someone? All right, none of you? All right. Go ahead and ask me if I had to drink all the wine to get these corks.
Nope.
Yes, I did, and I did it for you. Take a cork. There's a little exercise. Just be brave. Pass around. I boiled all these myself too, so. Let me take a cork. And yes, I buy cheap wine. Okay. I work in theater. So the most I can afford is the cheap wine. Sometimes I don't even use the screw top. I buy the screw. Ladies, want to try it? Okay.
Oh, I got the expensive one.
Oh, thank you.
Good stuff.
Anybody not get one? Anybody want one? I'm sorry, I didn't tell many of you. Did everybody get a little handout?
We appreciate your sacrifice.
Thank you.
He didn't want to.
Okay. This is very simple. Yeah, you got to do it. Welcome. Okay, you can do this in your cars on the way to work. People will look at you strangely. It's okay. It's good. All right. This is just to really loosen your face, give you a little vocal exercise, all right? Because a lot of us tend to be sloppy speakers, right? Which just really means that you're not using your articulators, but you need to, and you need to be able to do things with your voice. So when you're making a point, if you want to come down, you can come down, and when you want to go up, you can go up. You can be that little baby face person. You can do a lot, but the first thing is to articulate. So, this little exercise. I want you to just put this in your mouth and really take that first tongue twister, a big black bug, All right? Put the cork in your mouth, just like this. Be brave. Now, you're not going to bite hardly down on it. You're just going to enunciate around it. Go ahead. You can do it. Okay, that was pathetic.
Can I just say that I've never done this in a CLE before? This is my favorite CLE ever.
Okay, I want you to see how sloppy you were just then. And really, guys.
No, we need to talk about this.
The best law schools in the nation, and they can't get this right.
I don't understand this. All right, no, really go for the gusto here. Because you want to feel how much energy it takes to really articulate your words. Because here's what I don't want to hear when you're in court. I really want you to, you know what, who cares? Who cares? Own yourselves and your articulators. And yes, you can put that on your bulletin board. I own my articulators. Ready? Ready, now really watch this. The big black bug bit the big black bear, and the big black bear bled blood. You need to understand every word with a cork in your mouth. Okay, okay, everybody now, follow me. Ready? The big
black bug bit the big black bear, and the big black bear.
Slackers at this table! I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen, we have to stop right here. Late to the table here, Missy. Okay, let's use your example. Stand up. Please do it. Oh my God. See, this brings you back to when you were in the fifth grade.
Of course you would be. Stand up.
Okay, you're next.
Stepping up.
Okay, go ahead. No, put the cork in.
Okay. Is there a particular one you would want me to say?
I want to just stick with Big Black Bug right now, and then we're going to turn over to the one that's really hard.
This is how we haze our summer assistants.
Okay. Go ahead.
A big black bug, a big black bear, and a big black bear bled blood.
Okay, now really try it again. And I know it's hard, right? Because it's embarrassing.
I'm not very good at the English language either.
Yes, you are. You're brilliant at the English language. Do not try to cop out.
Okay.
Okay,
no,
try it again.
It's happening.
Also, I want you to feel the change in your mouth when you take it out. Because you're going to feel that you have more air in there and more space. Go ahead.
A big black bug bit a big black bear. And the big black bear bled blood.
Very nice. Okay, now seriously, did you hear a difference?
Yes.
You actually could hear a difference. And these are very simple things that you can do for yourself to make a difference.
Okay, I know you want to try it too, don't you?
not the first one, the second one.
The second.
What's your name?
Kim.
Kim, stand up, Kim. Okay. Be brave, be bold.
The deadly dagger and the dire dungeon dangled in the dank, dark dungeon.
Okay, but you actually said a word incorrectly.
Oh, I did. Okay.
Yes.
Okay, try again. The deadly dagger and the dire dungeon dangled in the dank, dark dungeon.
Right. Can everybody say that? That's very good. The deadly dagger and the dire dungeon dangled in the dank, dark dungeon. You actually have to move your mouth. You know, and yeah, that is an overstatement. But once you get used to moving your mouth, you actually learn to really move it. And I'm serious if I tell you, if you take these home and practice them just like that, drink the wine first. Only if you want to. It really does make a difference. It makes a difference in your confidence. It makes a difference in really standing up and doing your house. Also, standing up in your house, okay, presuming you have a home, I made a home with a little space. When I lived in New York, one of the reasons I moved to Florida, sidebar, I was in my apartment one day, which was very, very tiny. And I was looking at my walls, and I finally went, I have to break the wall! And I thought that was going a little too far, and I moved, which is now why I own a home in Florida, instead of living in a dungeon in New York. Okay, so when I want to torture my students, which I'm not going to do to you now, but if you can accomplish this in your life as articulators,
Give me the gift of a grip-top sock, a clip-draped, ship-shaped, tip-top sock. That's the one that I want you to work on next. I'm not going to do the whole thing because it would make us sad. It would. But you can do this for yourself. The other thing is just turn look at this last page where it shows you the action choices. These words are really what we do. When we talk about acting, you're always doing something because you want something. So you're always trying to make the right choice for what you're doing. And I'd like you to just look at these for a moment, because when you want to make a point, you want to choose the right way to make the point. And that is depending upon who you're talking to or what you want. You know, it really doesn't, might not help you as the lawyer to, let's see if I see what here, yeah, to rip somebody's guts out. That might be the choice you want, but it may not be the choice you want, depending on how you put your story together. But it is the choice. If that is the choice, then make that choice. You know, don't make a, I'm kind of going to get him. You know, kind of, sort of. Not words you want to use, because we're sloppy thinkers now. We become, I think, sloppy thinkers and sloppy talkers. See, I just said sloppy. You don't need that word in your vocabulary. You don't need like, sort of. You don't need to start with so. You know, we're starting to speak text talk also. You want to be very careful about that, because while you can do that, you know, you're doing this. If I'm on your jury, and I know I'm a little older than I am, and it is a generation thing, but if I'm listening to that, I'm going, wow, you can't speak, you don't speak well, and you don't speak articulately, and you don't speak in a fashion that uses, you know, I am a snob about that. I expect you to be educated. You've all gone to law school. So I expect you to have an education that goes with my opinion of what that means. So you do need to be careful in the same way that we all need to be careful with whatever we do. So there's the again. So I want to also, for some of you young lawyers, have you been in court yet? Okay. There's a lot of nerves, I think, that go along with your job, and a lot of tension, right? You're going from this to that, to this to that. You've got to think really fast. So I'm going to give you two exercises that you might want to take away with you. One is, I call it breathe for five. And it's breathe for five. And all it is when you have to go from one thing to another, and you have to go very, very quickly. It literally is paying attention to your breath as you breathe in for five and breathe out for five. And you do it five times. Just really, really simple. And you want to breathe into your belly. You don't, none of this. Now I'm breathing up here. You have a tendency to, you know, keep it all up here. Nuh-uh. iPhone. in the pockets.
Now that's something we can use in front of a jury.
You want to think this breath all the way deep into your belly. So you're breathing, and you want to close your eyes and just try it. You're breathing in for five, inhaling for five, and exhaling for five. And so you're breathing in. Close your eyes. One, two, three, four, five. And exhale. One, two, three, four, five. And inhale. And exhale. Deep into your belly. And what's different than a minute ago? Anything? Just gone. And it's the gift that you can give yourself. So if you're about to make a presentation, or you've been running all over the place, or running out of your car because you couldn't find that place to park, give yourself that. Do we have, can I do one more? That, can you all stand up? Lots of times when you're in our business, in the theater business, you're running from an audition, you're running back and forth all the time. So ladies, I'm sorry if you have dresses on. This is another really
easy way to just body language. See? Cute, right? To bring yourself, you're gonna go into your feet, and your feet are parallel, just parallel. And you're just gonna charge, we call charging up a little bit. Just a gentle little, that's it, just that. Your arms just to your sides. Your chin is parallel to the floor. You're feeling your spine, feeling really good. And you're gonna drop your chin into your chest, and you're going to drop down to the count of 25, and I'm gonna count that for you. So you're gonna stop the charging, and it's 1, 2, 3, 4, dropping down, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Your hands are gonna hold on to the floor if you get that down that far. Your head will touch the floor, no doubt, because you're that flexible. Not into the machine, however. Don't do it if you can't. And just hang there for a second. Just hang there. And you're breathing into your back, and your back is opening up. Your back is literally opening up. You're feeling it's a visualization. Drop your head, really drop your head though. Lawyers want to hang on to their heads. You know, no, you can drop it. It won't fall off, I promise. Expand into your back. Expand into your back, and now come up to the count of 25, a vertebra at a time. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25. Okay, what's different now? But you don't do this at home. You know, they say don't do this at home. No, do this at home.
You feel taller.
Really do this at home. Most of you got up by the count of 15. You know, like, okay, I'm bored now. Okay, I'm I know you want to get where you're going, young people, but no. You actually have to slow down. You know, slow down. Be present. Because if you're present in your life, you're going to be present when you're in court. You can't skip the steps, you know? Be present, because if you're present, that's what I see. I see a person also with a smile. Don't forget, you know, you can have a smile every now and then, it won't kill you, because that's what people also respond to. That also means that it looks like you're very confident. It's not a smarmy smile? Is that the word? It's not one of those.
Smarmy.
Smarmy. Don't be smarmy. But do look like a person that we want to know. All right? All right, thank you very much.
Three panelists. We have about 5 minutes for questions. So if anybody has any questions for any of our three.
No. You may have your cork, it's a present. I drank that wine for you.
Okay, well.
I would say that at Edster's here, we actually have a yoga class. And it's been great for the litigator. It's been great for me. And I just had a big argument in the federal court in the Southern District of New York, Lower Manhattan. It's like a big time court, and the judge was running a few minutes late, and it was just me and the other lawyers and waiting for the judge, and I just used the time to breathe. I mean, it really has become important to me to get relaxed and centered and all that. It's not just some new wavy mumbo jumbo. It's really good stuff. So.
Thank you. Yeah, it really does. It really will serve you just well and in life.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
Well, thank you all so much for coming to the CLE. We are done for the day. Please make sure to get your certificates of attendance from Melody or from Rachel right outside. That has the course number, so you can go to the Florida Bar website and register your credits for being here all day. Thank you so much to all of our panelists, and have a great night.
Yep, thank you very much.